Welcome to my video tutorial on identification of systemic histology slides, part 1. We will learn the following systemic histology slides in this video. There are 3 slides of central nervous system, cerebrum, cerebellum and spinal cord. In special senses, we will see cornea and retina. Endocrine system, in which we will see the pituitary, thyroid and adrenal glands. In respiratory system, trachea and lung. In total, we will be looking into 10 systemic histology slides. A note before we begin, slides shown in this video are hematoxylin and eosin stained slides which are available at routine histology lab for undergraduate students. The images are taken through a camera phone from monocular light microscope. Kindly ignore any artifacts in the slides. Let's begin with the central nervous system slides. Cerebrum. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by presence of pyramidal cells with their apex towards the surface. And the surface is covered by meninges. Cerebrum shows outer cortex or gray matter and inner medulla or white matter. Cells within the cerebral cortex are arranged in 6 layers. And the medulla contain myelinated nerve fibers. Let's see the layers within the cerebral cortex. Outermost layer is called as molecular layer, which has horizontal cells. Deep to that is the external granular layer with stellate cells. Deep to that, external pyramidal layer, which show small and medium-sized pyramidal cells, which are tightly packed. Deep to that is the internal granular layer with large number of stellate cells. Deep to that is the internal pyramidal or ganglionic layer with large pyramidal cells or cells of Betts, which are loosely packed. Deepest layer is multiform or pleomorphic layer with fusiform cells and cells of Martinotti. Let's see the cells of different layers of cerebral cortex under high magnification. Here is the outermost layer, molecular layer with horizontal cells. Here is the external granular layer with stellate cells. This layer also shows small sized pyramidal cells which are very less in number. Coming to the third layer, external pyramidal layer with small and medium sized pyramidal cells. This layer also show very less number of stellate cells. Here the slide is showing fifth layer, internal pyramidal or ganglionic layer with large pyramidal cells or cells of Betts. Here is the deepest layer, multiform or pleomorphic layer with fusiform cells and larger cells of Martinotti. Here is the medulla with nerve fibers and oligodendrocytes. So different layers in cerebral cortex can be identified under low magnification by presence of very less number of cells in outermost 2 layers and small and medium sized pyramidal cells which are tightly packed in the third layer, and large pyramidal cells or cells of Betts which are loosely packed in fifth layer. The point to be identified here is in motor cortex, pyramidal cells predominate, and in sensory cortex, stellate cells predominate. Cerebellum. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by presence of cerebellar folia with larger Purkinje cells. Cerebellum shows outer cortex or gray matter and inner medulla or white matter. Cells within the cerebellar cortex are arranged in 3 layers and the medulla contain myelinated nerve fibers. Let's see the layers in cerebellar cortex. Outermost layer called as molecular layer. Deep to that is the Purkinje cell layer and the deepest layer is granular layer. Let's observe the cells within the different layers of cerebellar cortex under high magnification. Here is the outermost layer, molecular layer, which shows smaller basket cells and larger stellate cells along with climbing and parallel fibers. Here is the deeper layer, Purkinje cell layer, which is a single cellular layer, shows a flask shaped Purkinje cells with centrally placed large nucleus. Dendritic processes projecting into outer molecular layer and axon into underlying granular layer. The deepest layer is the granular layer with granule cells and larger Golgi cells along with mossy fibers and synaptic glomeruli. Coming to the spinal cord, here is the cross section of spinal cord which can be observed completely under dissection microscope without any magnification. It can be identified by the presence of head-shaped gray matter with broad anterior horns and narrow posterior horns. They are connected through a central gray commissure around the central canal, which is lined by ependyma. Spinal cord is surrounded by meningeal layers and it shows a deep anterior median fissure and a narrow posterior median sulcus. Spinal cord contains outer white matter and inner gray matter. White matter contains axons of nerve fibers and it can be divided into anterior, lateral and posterior columns through which axons run in the form of ascending and descending tracts. In the anterior horns of gray matter, there are multipolar neurons and interneurons. Let's observe that under low magnification. Here is the broad anterior horn showing larger multipolar neurons and smaller interneurons. In thoracic region, spinal cord shows lateral horns, which also contain larger multipolar neurons and smaller interneurons. Here are the three slides of central nervous system. They are surrounded by meningeal layers. Cerebrum can be identified by presence of pyramidal cells in the cerebral cortex, and the cells are arranged in six layers. Cerebellum can be identified by the presence of cerebellar folia and larger Purkinje cells in cerebellar cortex, where the cells are arranged in three layers. Spinal cord can be identified by the presence of head-shaped gray matter with broad anterior horns and narrow posterior horns. Let's see the slides of special senses. Cornea. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by presence of regularly arranged collagen fibers covered by stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. Such cornea shows five layers. Let's observe these layers under high magnification. Outermost layer is called as anterior epithelium, formed by stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. Deep to that is the Bowman's membrane or anterior limiting membrane, which acts as basement membrane for the anterior epithelium. Deep to that is the thickest substantia propria, formed by regularly arranged collagen fibers with fibroblasts, which can be identified by their flat nuclei. Deep to that is the Descemet's membrane or posterior limiting membrane, which acts as basement membrane for the deepest layer, posterior epithelium, which is nothing but simple squamous endothelium. Such cornea is transparent because of its avascularity and regularly arranged collagen fibers, and the cornea is richly supplied by nerves. Retina. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by presence of 10 layers with nuclear layers and a single cellular ganglion cell layer. Let's observe these layers under high magnification. Here is the outermost layer called as pigment cell layer, formed by simple cuboidal epithelium with melanin granules. Deep to that is the rods and cones layer, formed by processes of rods and cone cells. Deep to that is the external limiting membrane, which is formed by processes of Müller cells. Deep to that is the outer nuclear layer, formed by nuclei of rods and cone cells. Deep to that is the outer plexiform layer, formed by synaptic nerve fibers from rods and cone cells and from bipolar cells. Deep to the outer plexiform layer is the inner nuclear layer, formed by bipolar cells, amacrine cells and horizontal cells. Deep to that is the thickest inner plexiform layer, which is formed by synaptic nerve fibers from bipolar cells and from ganglion cells. Deep to the inner plexiform layer is ganglion cell layer, which is a single cellular layer formed by larger ganglion cells. Their axons form the next deeper layer called as nerve fiber layer, which is limited by internal limiting membrane, which is formed by processes of Müller cells. Müller cells are the largest cells in the retina. They are oriented perpendicular to the axis of retina, and their processes form external and internal limiting membranes. Here are the two slides from special senses. Cornea can be identified by presence of regularly arranged collagen fibers covered by stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium, whereas retina can be identified by presence of 10 layers with the nuclear layers and a single cellular ganglion cell layer. Let's see the slides of endocrine system. Pituitary gland. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of clusters of cells in pars anterior, colloid filled vesicles in pars intermedia, and nerve fibers in pars posterior. Pars anterior and pars intermedia belong to adenohypophysis, whereas pars posterior is also known as neurohypophysis. Let's see the cells and their staining pattern under high magnification. Here is the pars anterior showing clusters of cells, out of which few cells take up the stain called as chromophiles and few cells do not take up the stain called as chromophobes. The cells which take up eosin stain are called as acidophils or eosinophilic cells, which secrete mammotrophs and somatotrophs. The cells which take up hematoxylin stain are called as basophils or basophilic cells, which secrete corticotrophs, gonadotrophs and thyrotrophs. The cells which do not take up the stain are called as chromophobes, which are pale staining cells, and their function is insignificant. Let's see the pars intermedia, which has colloid filled vesicles and loosely packed pale staining cells, which may secrete melanocyte stimulating hormone. Coming to the pars posterior, which has unmyelinated nerve fibers with herring bodies at their nerve terminals, where they store vasopressin and oxytocin. Such nerve fibers are supported by supporting cells called as pituicytes. Here they are. Thyroid gland. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of lobules with colloid filled follicles and parafollicular cells. Thyroid gland is surrounded by fibrous capsule which sends septa into the parenchyma and divide it into lobules. Each lobule shows different sized follicles filled with colloid, which is eosinophilic material formed by thyroglobulin. Each follicle is lined by follicular cells. Follicular cells show variation in their shapes depending on the activity of the tissue. When the thyroid gland is inactive, the follicular cells become squamous in type. When the gland is active, they become cuboidal in type. Let's observe that under high magnification. Here are the colloid filled follicles lined by follicular cells. Here they are cuboidal in shape, identified by their spherical nuclei, which means here the tissue is active in stage. Between the follicles, there are groups of cells known as parafollicular cells or C cells. They are pale staining cells with eccentrically placed nucleus, and they secrete calcitonin, whereas the follicular cells secrete T3 and T4 hormones. Coming to the adrenal gland or suprarenal gland, here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of capsule, and the parenchyma is divided into outer cortex, inner medulla. The cells of adrenal cortex are polyhedral cells and they are arranged in three zones. From outside to inside, they are zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata and zona reticularis. Zona glomerulosa and reticularis form outer and inner 1/5 of adrenal cortex, whereas zona fasciculata forms middle 3/5 of adrenal cortex. Let's see the arrangement of cortical cells in different zones under high magnification. Here is the capsule, and here is the outer zona glomerulosa, where the polyhedral cells are arranged in either oval-shaped or inverted U-shaped groups, and they secrete mineralocorticoids. Here is the zona fasciculata, where the polyhedral cells are arranged in straight columns separated by sinusoids. The cells contain lipid material in their cytoplasm and they take up less amount of eosin, which gives a spongy appearance to the adrenal cortex. They secrete glucocorticoids. Coming to the deepest zone, zona reticularis. Here the polyhedral cells are arranged in branching and anastomosing cellular cords, separated by capillaries. They take up more amount of eosin. They secrete sex hormones like androgens. Coming to the adrenal medulla, here it is. It shows large polyhedral cells called as chromaffin cells, as they contain chromaffin granules in their cytoplasm. They are arranged in groups and separated by sinusoids. They belong to sympathetic system and they secrete catecholamines. So here are the three slides belong to endocrine system. Pituitary gland can be identified by the presence of clusters of cells in pars anterior, colloid filled vesicles in pars intermedia, nerve fibers in pars posterior. Thyroid gland can be identified by the presence of lobules with colloid filled follicles and parafollicular cells. Adrenal gland can be identified by the presence of capsule, three zones in the cortex and large cells in the medulla. Now let's see the slides of respiratory system. Trachea. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of hyaline cartilage, which is covered by pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. The wall of trachea is composed of four layers. From inside to outside they are mucosa, submucosa, cartilaginous layer and adventitia. Let's see the features of mucosa under high magnification. It is lined by pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium with goblet cells and it is supported by underlying lamina propria, which is composed of loose connective tissue with blood vessels. Coming to the submucosa, which is formed by loose connective tissue with more number of elastic fibers and blood vessels, nerve fibers, along with serous and mucous glands. Outside to that is the cartilaginous layer, which is formed by hyaline cartilage. It is surrounded by perichondrium. Outermost layer is the adventitia, which is formed by loose connective tissue with blood vessels. Let's see the lung tissue. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It can be identified by the presence of alveoli, alveolar sacs, intrapulmonary bronchus and bronchioles. Alveoli can be identified by their thin wall, which is lined by simple squamous epithelium having type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes. Intrapulmonary bronchus, it can be identified by the presence of irregular plates of hyaline cartilage in its wall. And it is lined by pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Coming to the bronchiole, it can be identified by the absence of hyaline cartilage and presence of more smooth muscles in its wall. And it is lined by columnar epithelium without goblet cells. Here is the terminal bronchus having a piece of hyaline cartilage in its wall. Here is the terminal bronchiole without any hyaline cartilage in its wall, which continues as respiratory bronchiole, which can be identified by presence of alveoli opening into the respiratory bronchiole. It is lined by cuboidal epithelium. It continues as alveolar ducts, which receive alveolar sacs with alveoli. Here are the two slides belong to respiratory system. Trachea can be identified by the presence of hyaline cartilage and pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Lung tissue can be identified by the presence of alveoli, alveolar sacs, intrapulmonary bronchus with irregular plates of hyaline cartilage in its wall, and bronchiole without any hyaline cartilage in its wall, respiratory bronchiole by receiving alveoli into it. Here is the end of this video, which includes systemic histology slides belong to central nervous system, special senses, endocrine system and respiratory system. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.